Good evening, everybody. If we can stand for the pledge.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
How is everybody? Just one second. Of course, I just got logged out of the system. I apologize, let me just move this. We're going to start with our introduction and the approval of our new MASIC student representative. So, Joe, do you want to come up and introduce them, please?
Sure, absolutely.
Thank you.
I think we made their night. They were all excited to see their name tags. Yeah, I know they made it big time. I don't even have a name tag. I just would like to introduce Amit Gupta and Kanu Kaplash. Amit and Kanu will be joining Ali Moravec, who's down at the soccer field right now, playing soccer. All three of our board reps are very strong academic students. Ironically, they're all on the robotics team. In addition to a number of extracurriculars, Kanu is going to be our junior class representative this year. He's also the founder of our environmental research program called Gaia in school. Amit, in addition to a number of academic awards, and you're probably going to hear his name repeatedly throughout the year, he was our governor scholar last year, which was, he's one of only 30 juniors in the state to be recognized. We haven't had a governor scholar here in quite a few years. Amit was our governor scholar last year. He's also a national merit scholar semifinalist as well. He's pretty much our leader of the debate team. So Amit Gupta will be our senior representative. So Kanu and Amit will be joining Ali this year, and I look forward to some great things with them.
Great, thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Do I have a motion to approve Kanu and Amit? Sorry, thank you. Do I have a second? Thank you. I have a motion and a second to approve Kanu Kaplish. That's correct, right? Okay. Amit Gupta and Ali Moravec as the 2015-16 Student Board of Education representatives. Anybody have any discussion on that? Okay, hearing none, all in favor? Thank you very much. Welcome to the board. We are very happy to have you aboard and reporting to us what's happening at MASIC this year. We will move on to the report of the chairman. And before we get to our donation, I want to introduce our new board member. James Martinez is replacing Amy Primorak, who resigned because she took a position here at MASIC High School. So James is replacing her, and his term will expire on November 7, 2017. James has been an educator for 27 years. He's a principal of an elementary school in Norwalk. He's an adjunct professor at Mercy College in Westchester, New York, and he has two sons, one at MASIC and one in starting kindergarten next year. Thank you. We are happy to have you aboard here. We're happy to have you aboard here with us.
Thank you so much, and I couldn't be happier to be here. Thank
Great.
You.
Did you want to say anything? Are you out? Good?
No, I'm good. Okay. Yeah.
Great, thank you. All right, we will move on to item A, which is acceptance of a donation from Minds in Motion. And I know the three people are here, Brooke Berlin, Amy Primorak, and Mike Massaro. So if you'd like to come up here to the microphone, we'd love to have you up.
Please, Dad,
yes.
So thank you for having us. We represent Monroe Organized Voters for Education, and we every year, in conjunction with the CAG, which is the Connecticut Association for the Gifted, right? Although we co-create the Minds in Motion event, which is a hugely successful event. It really has nothing to do with gifted. And thanks to the good folks here, we make use of the building to do that. We do this every year, and it does generate a modest amount of income. We hope with your help this year that we're going to have an even bigger, much more successful event. And of course, the bigger the event, the more income that's generated. And when we do get that income, our mission is to put it right back into education. So having said that, this year we have $1,500 to donate. We'd like to donate it to the public schools for the specific purpose of supporting robotics. Okay, so I'm going to just give that check to the money woman over there.
Well, and, actually, they're going to want to take a picture to post it, so we'll go over there and accept it formally.
There you go.
Use the Zoom feature, Jack.
All right.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it. All right, thank you very much. We appreciate that donation, and I'm sure the robotics team would be very appreciative of that gift to help them on their journey and their traveling when they go to Worlds and all their Tennessee, right? That's it? Or no, they're moving it, right?
I think they're going to stay in Tennessee this year, right?
Kentucky.
I'm sorry, yeah.
Great. All right, we will move on then to the consent agenda. Do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda? Thank you. Do I have a second? Thank you. I have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. Do we have any discussion on the consent agenda this evening? Hearing none, all in favor? Thank you. Okay, reports of the committees and liaisons. Our MASIC student reps will be up first to discuss their items.
Just some updates for MASIC. This Wednesday is Yom Kippur, so there will be no school, and teachers, in respect for the Jewish community, will not be assigning homework over the holiday, and there will be no quizzes on Thursday. This weekend is a Catalyst prep boot camp held here at MASIC, and it's mostly for the seniors because it is focusing on the traditional SAT, which is going to take place on October 3rd.
Next Wednesday, September 30th, we'll be issuing progress reports electronically to all students at MASIC. That marks the halfway point of quarter one. October 1st will be the orientation of pupil services for sophomores. This is to help them go over what will soon become a relationship that they're going to need to start developing with their guidance counselors in order to work through the college process that becomes really important in their junior and senior years. So Mr. Kabza, I believe Ms. O'Doy, go through the pupil services and what it means and what they can do to help out the students, especially the sophomores then. In terms of sports news, tomorrow is a cross-country senior night for boys and girls. Boys is at 4:30 p.m., girls is at 5 p.m., so if anybody can go help support the teams, the younger kids on the teams will be kind of paying homage to the seniors there as it's the last home meet for those teams. Football is doing really well at MASIC right now. They're 2-0. Girls soccer right now is having their game at Stadium Field, which is why our fellow representative Allie is not here right now. And girls field hockey on October 1st will be having a Stick It to Cancer fundraising game. So that's to help raise money for cancer research. So if anybody in the community can come help support the team, of course, help support the cause to bring research to cancer treatments. That's it.
Great. Thank you so much. We will move on to Communications Committee. Mrs. Crouch.
The Communications Committee met tonight. We started off by recognizing that April 5th of 2016 will be the first budget vote, and we strategized a bit about key constituents that we need to reach out to, including the very successful Retirees Breakfast here at MASIC, Parents Council, PTOs. The timing of the Da Vinci Festival is very key to the budget vote.
We are going to televise the budget workshops and have those prominently displayed on the homepage so people can get budget information after the fact. And then we also thought it might be a good idea to reach out to CABE and see if they had some suggestions for some new ideas or new ways to communicate budget information. Having said all that, we also decided that perhaps we might consider changing the timing of the newsletter that goes out to have it come out in March. And while we can't publicly say, please support the budget, we can talk about a lot of the new positive things that are happening that are a result of, you know, supporting the budget and all of that. We're going to take all this and develop something of a timeline working back and determining when we need to do key things, but it was a really good discussion, and I think you know, we've got some good foundations in place for this next year. Again, it's always about getting parents, you know, energized and reminding them why it's important to get out and vote the first time, even though it is Monroe. We also reviewed the communication survey that was done last year. If you'll recall, 92% of the respondents said that they felt communications had improved. So how do we build on that? And there was one thematic that came out regarding the improvement of individual teachers' email web pages. So there has been a lot of progress throughout the district to improve communications and creativity on individual teachers' websites. And that's a really good thing. And we also, because of that, have had momentum with Facebook and really highlighting the student of the month, and then again the newsletter. So these are all solid bedrocks of what we're doing communications wise. We can always improve, but we feel like we've got some good momentum going forward. Great. So more to come.
Great, thank you so much. Does anybody have any other committee reports that we didn't cover that we want to talk about anything? Okay. We will move on to public participation. If anybody in the public would like to speak, just please come up to the microphone and state your name and address for the record. All right, hearing none, we will move on to report of the superintendent.
On the last page in your packet, well, you have your packet on your website, is the budget timeline. I just want to review that with you. It's hard to believe that we start this process so early, but we are about to start it, okay? And it usually starts in October, or early, mid-October, with me having meetings with all of our cost centers where they bring their budget presentations to me, and we talk about what can be omitted, what can be put off, what can be added. All of those discussions take place all the way up until November 13th. And then typically by the 20th, we have a draft superintendent's budget that we begin working on. And within about a two-week period, we have the first presentation of the budget. So you'll notice that we have two. We have the December 7th, we have my budget to you is presented. The 9th and the 14th are proposed budget workshops. If you recall last year, I think we had three dates there, and then we chose not to use one of them, so I just put two there this year. And then we have a regular board meeting on the 21st of December, and then ultimately the board adopts a budget. It becomes the board's budget on January 4th. Okay, by January 8th, that needs to go to the first selectman and then to the town council. By February 28th, the town council budget is submitted to the Board of Finance. And by March, the Board of Finance, the mill rate is set and the budget submitted to the town clerk for the referendum. And the referendum again is on April 5th, 2016 this year. So we're about to start that process again. It consumes a good portion of our time throughout the winter months. And as Mrs. Crouch said, we're going to do our best to keep it in front of the public's eye throughout the entire process. The ad hoc presentation, I think we have the date set now. We're going to post the meeting and notify everyone. That's going to be on October 12th at 7 p.m. here, so that that can be televised. Town Council, Board of Finance, and the Board of Education, and then the public is more than welcome to attend. This is the culmination of almost 3 years of work that the ad hoc committee has done in an investigation of demographics and facilities, and we encourage as many people as we can to attend and see the presentation and what the ultimate recommendations are from the ad hoc committee to the board. And that's it.
Great. Any questions? All right, moving on. We will move on to presentations, and first up is Counseling Services in Monroe, and Anna Doy is going to lead us in that. Is she going to need the projector?
You're using this, so okay. Yeah, we're going to move.
Thank you.
Very much for giving us some time this evening to talk about the school counseling services here in the Monroe School District. We're really honored to be here, and it's really wonderful all of our counselors were able to come out tonight to present themselves to you. Some of them I'm sure you're familiar with, some of them possibly not, but we feel very, very proud of all the great work they're doing with all the students of Monroe. I really wanted to take the time to introduce them. We have Mia Cueva. Mia is a counselor over at Stepney and Fawn Hollow. Tracy Sacco is our Monroe Elementary School counselor, our 0.6 counselor. John Bevilacqua, full-time counselor at the STEM school. Catherine Johnson and Romina Bordolis are over at Jockey Hollow Middle School. We have Lori Rico, who is a school psychologist, but the position Elder Alternative was a school counseling position. And she takes care of those kids over at the alternative school. Kathy Keene, Mary Lou Matat, Penny Plosky, Megan Scanlon, and Beth Young are all our high school counselors here with us this evening. And myself, who I'm the instructional leader for school counseling and a Massac High School counselor for the past 15 years. So thank you everybody for being here this evening. Just a little breakdown for everybody. At Fawn Hollow and Stepney, where Mia takes care of all those kids, she's basically a 0.5 counselor for 497 students. And at Stepney, a 0.5 counselor for 430 students, okay? So that's probably a ratio of about 927 students per counselor. At Monroe L, Tracy Sacco's in charge and taking care of 354 students. Jockey Hollow, we have two full-time counselors, 561 students, a 280 ratio. John is over at STEM, 221 students. At Alternative, where Lori is, there's 15 students. And over at Massac High School, with about 1,108 students, we have about 206 students per counselor. The goal this evening is twofold, is to definitely share with you all the great things we're doing at Massac High School, at the elementary schools, at the middle schools, but it's also to present to you one of the challenges we're seeing right now. I've been taking a look at the school counseling departments for the last 3 years, and there's a challenge, and we're hoping that we're real hopeful that people are aware and will be able to respond to it. We have a slide, role of the school counselor in the district. I think when we put it in there, when we put the blackness of it. The role of school counselor in the district is twofold. We're supporting all of the students socially and emotionally. There's lots of research put out that says, you know, if you support each student emotionally, socially, it does lead to more academic success and achievement. And we do have lots of research proving that. Our goal with the Monroe School District is to be proactive, okay, not reactive to crises. So we're looking to give students skills, strategies, tools, so that crises don't end up in a real negative way. It's preventative, that kids know ahead of time what they need to do, who they need to see in order to get the support they need. And we use it as a crisis model, but we also say about opportunities. There's lots of great students here in the Monroe School District. There's lots of great opportunities we try to offer each of the kids through engineering, and sometimes Yale has different forums, and if we know students are interested in education or want to be a pre-med student, we offer them opportunities, all proactive things to get kids engaged from all levels. We have five different components to the role of the school counselor: student programs, parent programs, the community outreach, individual group counseling, and we are 504 case managers for our students as well, and we'll talk about. And the fifth role we play is we're implementers of the Connecticut Comprehensive School Counseling Curriculum. So we like to say that our role in the district is fivefold. We approach all of those. Student programs, Red Ribbon Week, Rock Week, that's a Jockey Hollow Middle School initiative. It's an anti-bullying, anti-drug initiative. It definitely takes the place of a more positive, upbeat kind of celebration, trying to get kids to feel good about themselves, self-esteem, motivation. The whole week is devoted to that. Skits are done in the gym. Kids are taking turns, role-playing different things. How do you resist peer pressure? It really is a tremendous program. I've been down there. And it just gives the awareness to the kids about making good decisions. And it's not something that it's just one week. This kind of language and integration pretty much is pervasive throughout the school year, but it's given a week. The Rock Week is a random act or random opportunities of caring and kindness. Okay, so that's a whole week of kids speaking to one another, sending letters to custodians, bus drivers, thanking them for all of what they do. It's also putting hearts on everybody's lockers and, you know, making kids feel like they belong, like people care about them. And it's, once again, it's 1 week devoted to it, but it's also carried throughout the rest of the year. Sikorsky Career Day, Parent Speakers for Career Information. This was a STEM Jockey Hollow program. We brought in a helicopter that flew over Massac High School, and they presented different careers also to the students. It wasn't just the cool helicopter, which is very cool to see landing down at the field, but it also presented some careers. There was career engineering fair in the Massac gym, and also at the STEM program, they bring in parent speakers to talk to the kids about careers. And that's throughout the course of the year. Naviance is a great college career program. They started in sixth grade. They move it, and you know, we use it very heavily here at the high school. And it's college career learning styles inventory. We're getting kids involved in sixth grade, trying to help them become more aware earlier about all their opportunities, good decisions. Education can open many, many doors for you, no matter who you are. And Naviance helps kids identify that. Over at Massac High School, we have Career Day. Over, you know, 100 plus careers descend upon us. Different parents and also people of the community represent different careers, and we have the student body come into the gymnasium. That's run with our counselor and career center coordinator, Mrs. Mancuso, and our citizens advisory committee. So we're reaching out. That's usually, I think, October, November time. Alumni Day, we have all the kids coming back from colleges talking to our seniors. Hey, what's it like in college? What's the real deal? Was I prepared for college? Listen to your English teacher, grammar's everything. Like, they come back with great stories, and it really does enlighten the seniors about, okay, this, there's a reason your teachers are demanding and asking all of this of you. We also, at the guidance department, we do administer the PSATs, SATs, AP, CAPT. To all the students. We are going to be introducing the PSAT 10, the PSAT 8 and 9 also this year with the changing of the SATs. And also we help orchestrate all the underclassmen senior awards. So that's one part of what counselors do across K through 12, student programs that we run, parent programs. We have a whole list of parent programs. There's PTA in the Monroe Elementary School, basically introducing to that group of people, you know, what the great programs are that we're running over at the elementary school. At Alternative School, they started a parent holiday breakfast, which, you know, there's about 15 students at Alternative School. Connections are very, very important. Family connections are extremely important, and just getting parents out to show up makes some huge, huge strides and makes really a significant impressions on the kids. So they started that holiday breakfast last year. There's back to school night for orientation for the sixth graders. Over at Jockey Hollow, they have a nice organization anxiety chat with the principal and guidance counselors if there's any concerns with any of the students. We know there's lots of pressure these days on the students. We feel it. I can say in all of my time here, there is more cases of anxiety and I would say mental health support, needs for mental health support than I've ever seen. And, you know, probably the culture of our American society, probably a lot of things, but, you know, these are things we're trying to be proactive about and talk to parents about. How can you help your child? We're trying to help them too, so that they have a really harmonious, positive time here. We have freshman parent orientation. Amit talked about the sophomore parent information night Joe and I give to the parents. Junior and college planning night. We start with all the juniors in November, start talking about the whole college process. We are making sure everybody will have a post-secondary plan, whether you're a college person, you're going into the workforce, you're going into the military. It's very important for us to make sure every student has a plan, and we reach out. For parents, financial aid night, college funding, the FAFSA form, all the money talk stuff, and we expanded this last year. Ryan Daly, who takes care of all of us electronically, I don't know, he takes care of us all the time, but his dad is a FAFSA guru from the state, so he donated his time, and we had about 25 to 35 parents actually fill out their FAFSA form here in the library and press send and be like, oh my God, I'm so happy I'm done with the FAFSA. And these are just other services we're offering the parents, because it's not just a journey for the student, it's also a journey for the parents with all this college. So we're always asking parents, what can we do better? What do you need more information? And we do have a lots of support from the administration to make these happen. Scholarship Quest Night, understanding your award letter, that was Discover Card. They offered their services to come and talk to the parents. We had some tremendous positive responses in regard to that. So the parents are aware of what they can do to help with the financial pieces of college and also underclassmen and senior awards. So student programs, parent programs, community outreach. I'm talking K through 12, we're all doing all of these things. Like I said before, and like all of us feel in the counseling, and I'm sure you feel it as a parent or a community member, you know, we are definitely seeing a surge of lots of mental health issues coming through. Anxiety, depression, these are things that we deal with every day, you know, in the first 2 weeks at Massac High School. And, you know, lots of great things are happening, but, you know, it's a stressful place for many people. We already dealt with like 15 cases of different areas of suicidal ideation, anxiety, depression. Okay, how do we deal with divorce? How do we deal with teen dating violence? These are all issues that presented in the first 2 weeks of school at the high school. And I know at the elementary schools and middle schools, you know, it's not pervasive across everything. We have kids being National Merit Scholars and doing things, but we know these kids have a lot to do. You guys have a lot to do, we know that. And that they're here tonight is awesome. But, you know, part of our outreach all the time is connecting with kids. And, you know, when you're sitting behind a door, you have a one-to-one relationship with that person to help them process. And one of our goals, you know, we connect with the town social worker as much as we can to get kids on Husky insurance if they need it. You know, we have kids coming in our offices who are not being treated medically because they have no insurance. And, you know, we reach out to the community and say, oh, how can we get this person hooked up? Our goal for all of these students on all different levels, and we're talking about all students. It's not just a targeted group. Oh, it's these kids. It's pervasive through all academic levels of students, is to get them connected in the outside. Outside referrals, Mia Cueva put together a program last year that brought in about 6 counselors, therapists, social workers, psychologists, came into the building. They introduced themselves, they talked to us. We made a counseling referral booklet, which is somewhere, that we gave to all the psychologists and administrators and counselors to say, these are people we know, these are people we feel good about, and we talk to parents and get kids hooked up as much as possible. There's only so much we can do behind the closed door in the middle of school. Some of these kids are dealing with very intense depth traumatic issues, and opening their soul and their heart up is not really, you know, the responsible thing for us to do. It's to hear it, listen, and let's get them connected so that they can pursue some healing on the outside. So that is a huge part of what we do as well. At the elementary school, they facilitate a lot of groups through divorce, stress, organization at the middle school too. So that's a piece of what we do every day with our children here at Monroe. We are 504 case managers. 504 students are students with a mental health disability that have accommodations for whatever reason. It doesn't mean that if you have a mental health disability or a mental health situation, that you are a 504 student. It all really depends. It's if you need accommodation. So we all track those at all levels, okay? These are a little bit of the breakdown of all the schools and the 504s, but these are students that we really watch out. We check in with, we make sure they're doing okay. Sometimes we see them every day, helping them through the school year for 186 days. Sometimes we see them more infrequently like that. So this is just a little breakdown of, you know, each of the counselors are responsible to support. And part of our support is supporting teachers. You know, sometimes many teachers need conversations about these students. We sit down in the teams.
And yes, let me just interrupt and just make sure the board understands that Section 504 is of the ADA, Americans with Disabilities Act. It can be any disability that negatively impacts their ability to learn, okay, or in accessing the learning, okay? So it could be a broad spectrum, physical, mental, all kinds of issues.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. And the fifth part of what we do is our comprehensive school counseling program. This is a guide. This was given by the state of Connecticut. All of our programs are targeted through this curriculum, and we try to implement as much as we can in regard to the curriculum, kindergarten through 12th grade. We follow we are going to be revealing our curriculum in January, and that will be going online, and we'll be finishing that. But at this point, I just wanted to, you know, introduce each counselor from each school, each actually grade level, just to speak to you really, really briefly. I'm trying to talk fast. I don't want to keep people too long, but to talk briefly a little bit about our curriculum. So this is another piece that we do, is go into classrooms and actually, and on the second handout that you got, there's the PowerPoint, but also there's a second handout. And basically what it does, it just gives you the topics that are covered in each of the different grade levels from kindergarten through 12th grade. So it's just like a little makeshift thing here. Our first person to come on up would be Tracy Sacco, who's the Monroe Elementary School counselor. So Trace, if you don't mind.
Good evening. Thanks for having us here today. As mentioned before, at the elementary school, the counselors see students in groups and meet with them individually. We meet with them on all sorts of things, like helping them better manage their feelings and emotion, build friendship and social skills, build their self-esteem, talk and deal with separation, divorce, or changes in the family. These individual meetings and groups are often created as a reaction to something that we see in the students or that they need. Groups and individual meetings are for a smaller number of students. A bulk of our time at Monroe Elementary School is but in the classroom, where we get to see every single student and help them in a proactive way rather than a reactive way. I teach children skills in academic, career, and social emotional aspects of student development, and just as any curriculum, the lessons are built upon themselves each year. For example, in kindergarten, students start to learn to identify different feelings they may have. Each year we build upon that, learning how to manage and control feelings, and then eventually recognizing that feelings are conveyed through more than just words, but through body language, tone of voice, and facial expressions as well. You have the handout in front of you with the breakdown of the lessons I'm able to do at Monroe Elementary School every year, but the themes over the year include building self-esteem, friendship, social skills, character development, managing feelings, accepting differences, respecting ourselves and others, and school success skills like time management, among other topics. I visit each grade level every few weeks and see all of our classes 7 to 8 times a year. The number goes up in fifth grade. We do a drug and alcohol unit along with some transition lessons. I provide 3 to 6 lessons in the classroom each week throughout the year. In addition to the curriculum lessons, sometimes we notice a whole grade or a class having a typical or one area that they need some help in, and I go in and provide an additional lesson in those areas when necessary. One of the important aspects of the classroom lessons are that the teachers stay for the lessons and every day reinforce the ideas taught. Often at the end of a lesson, a teacher is left with a poster or something for their classroom for students to refer to. Teachers are constantly reminding students to use the skills they learned in the lessons. One example is the use of an I feel statement as a way to assert or stand up for oneself. Students begin learning this in kindergarten. The statements are used to let others know how they are feeling and what others are doing to make them feel that way. Students start to build the skills and confidence to handle situations on their own. It builds a common language for students to talk to and understand one another when handling conflict. Some of you may have heard your children through the years using this, and maybe next year you'll hear one of your kids using the I feel statement as well. The lessons help students learn the expected behaviors in our building, which has helped develop a positive climate in our building. Thanks to the lessons, I am able to get to know every single student in the building. More importantly, thanks to my visibility through these lessons, every student in the building gets to know me, what I am there for, and learns that there is someone they can go to if they ever need help. Even the kindergartners, at this point in the year, I've seen every single one of them in the classroom. They may not know my specific name, but they have been known to ask their teacher, can I go talk to that lady who helps me with my sad feelings? So they all know where to find me. These classroom lessons are an essential aspect to building a positive school climate and a place where every single student feels there's an adult in the building they can go to for help when they need it. Thank you. John Bevilacqua is next from the middle school.
And these are just positive quotes that teachers have had about the elementary school lessons. It's in the PowerPoint, and we also have feedback from also students' responses to the school lessons, also in the PowerPoint for you to take a look at.
I can't say enough about what Tracy said and what she does and how important that early foundation of being experienced and seeing a counselor on a regular basis early in the elementary school, because it builds it. For them coming into the middle school. I'm John Bevilacqua, I'm the school counselor over at STEM, but I am here to represent the entire Jockey Hollow family. It is our goal to meet with students as much as possible. We spend a great deal of time in the classrooms as well to build those relationships that will help students through the very difficult times that they may face during their middle school time in Jockey Hollow and at STEM. I spend 2 to 3 periods a day. I am scheduled in to teach developmental guidance lessons over at Jockey Hollow. They spend a great deal of time in the classrooms as well. A lot of my projects are technology-based. They are always presentations and learning activities related to skits, short films, and presentations are shared across grade levels related to guidance. Some of the topics I cover in sixth grade are study skills and organization, as well as all the topics that you have in your handout as well. High school and college readiness and careers, leadership in the community, being an active, helpful citizen, and I try to do a very special project in each of the grade levels. The sixth grade project that is the most special is an All About Me project. They do it in the beginning of the year, and it is their life from early on to the present day and how they have grown and developed and all of the positive things that they've done. And they share this with all the students so that we can get to know them. And it's a self-esteem building activity as well. Knud can probably remember that project back then. In seventh grade, we again cover organization, high school preparedness, college careers, building and maintaining relationships with peers and teachers and community members. And their special project is a huge bullying film that each child or groups of children create, and then they share that among the grade levels as well. And some of the projects are just, they are so phenomenally put together. And the learning that takes place from them showing each other what the expected behaviors are in terms of helping each other out in regards to bullying and mean-spirited behavior is unbelievable. I've shared a lot of it with Ann, and it's really creative stuff. In eighth grade, we teach them their role and responsibilities as a student, a family member, and as an active member of the community and society. Again, we touch on high school preparedness and college preparedness and careers. I cap it off with healthy living choices, texting while driving, hazing activity, and stuff like that. We really try to kind of cover the gamut. And then they have a very special project as well. It is a project that is related to how they've changed in middle school, and it goes directly back to their All About Me project, where they kind of reflect about how they've changed from their All About Me project to the present day in terms of their responsibility, academic awareness, their preparedness for high school. And they go and they present that project back to sixth and seventh graders and are able to kind of mentor those children through the changes that need to take place for children through the middle school years. And it's unbelievable just to see them present these things. Some of them become so creative. Some of them make films about how they've changed. Some of them just come up and do a PowerPoint. But it's amazing to see what they can do after the 3 years in a middle school environment where there is this developmental counseling piece. Thank you.
And Beth Young and Penny Klosky will be talking about 9th to 12th grade. Beth Young will be speaking about the 9th and 10th graders.
Good evening.
Former elementary school counselor.
I was just going to say that. I have such a unique perspective because in my time here in Monroe, I spent 11 years at Monroe Elementary School. And during that time, I also spent part of my time up here. So I was part-time in both buildings. And this is my third year full-time at the high school. So I have really a unique perspective in seeing the whole range of the K-12 developmental guidance, just missing those couple of years in the middle school. And it's been very, very enjoyable for me to reconnect with kids that I knew from Monroe Elementary now that they're huge and grown and changed so much. But there's a lot of opportunity for us to reflect back on the lessons that I know that I gave them when they were younger and carry it through now at a more mature level. So I'll talk to you a little bit about that. First of all, we start our ninth grade curriculum really in eighth grade when we go down and do course selection. All of the high school counselors spend time with all of the middle school students. We sit one-on-one and we talk about what classes they're recommended for and why they might be recommended for them, and talk about electives, and we help them register for classes. Many of them are doing some of that registration themselves, but we can get into their PowerSchool account and we can look at what they signed up for, and we have a nice conversation about that. So we start that in February of eighth grade. And then we also this past year implemented a more formal eighth grade transition program. And there's lots and lots of ninth grade orientation. We have a Fresh Fest, which I'm sure you've all heard about. But at the end of May, myself and some of the other counselors went down into the middle school classrooms and spent a full classroom lesson talking, sort of relaxed and comfortable, talking about the nitty-gritty of high school, like, do you have time to go to your locker, and all of those kind of nervous questions that the kids ask, and talking about the schedule of the day. And I think it was well received. It was very, very enjoyable for me. And the kids seem to really like it and get excited about coming to Massac. We do some more formal classroom lessons that I'm going to talk about in a minute, but one of the things we do with all of our ninth graders is we visit their advisory classes. And if you don't know, advisory is a short period of time, usually 20-25 minutes every other week. Sometimes it's longer for a more formal assembly or presentation, but at the bare minimum, they're doing grade level classroom activities. The students are assigned to an advisory, the same advisory, all 4 years with the same adult, small group of, you know, 10, 15 students. So it's a way to take a big school and make it smaller. It's a great opportunity as counselors to have access to our freshmen right away, right at the beginning of school. So the first few advisories, the first couple of months, we'll buzz around to, there's usually about 3 to 4 advisories that would have our part of the alphabet, so to speak. And we'll go in and we'll talk to them about their adjustment and answer questions. And then when the first report card comes out, we talk about what a GPA is and what's important and how it counts going forward. So that's a sort of more informal time to get in and see all of our freshmen. Formally, we have 2 formal lessons, one in the fall and one in the spring. In the fall, we meet with all of the classes. Our teachers are generous to give up a class period, and we usually work with the Chromebooks and we do some technology, but the first lesson in ninth grade is talking about goal setting, and that's something that we also do at the elementary level and middle school as well. So we talk about setting 3 goals, setting a personal goal for high school. Maybe it's to make certain grades or get more friends or join a club or something. We talk about an academic goal and we talk about a career goal, which could be career/college. I'm gonna find out what GPA I need to get into UConn. That's my goal. I'm gonna see what it is. So we do that and we get the kids onto Naviance where they type in their goals, and we also start them building their high school resume. So we show them how to do that on Naviance so that we're encouraging them to constantly revise and add to that throughout high school, so that when it comes to the college application process, they're not going, wait, what did I do in ninth grade? They've sort of gotten in the habit of updating that. And so that's in the fall. In the spring, we do a little bit more of career exploration where we do a sort of interest inventory, and we talk to the kids about what is it that you like to do? What do you enjoy? And there's also through Naviance a big online assessment, and we spend a lot of time talking about the results and how to interpret those results. And so in addition to, you know, doing, there'll be a 8-9 PSAT right now, and so career exploration is our spring unit, and then they're also doing course registration where we're meeting with all of the students as well. But as far as the developmental guidance curriculum, there's 2 formal presentations. In 10th grade, we continue with the career exploration in the fall, and this time our focus is on what are you good at? Because not just what you like, but what are your strengths? Because the kids always laugh about that. I always tell them I really enjoy art, but I could never get a job in the art field because I have no skill in that. So talking about careers that match what your passion is with also what your strengths are, and that there's ways to find careers that might put those 2 things together, even if you think you can't. So again, we're working with Naviance, and we're having the discussions are fantastic. The kids have a lot of fun with that. And then later in the year, in the spring, because all of our 10th graders have taken the PSAT, we will do a sort of PSAT score interpretation and College Board. We set them all up with a College Board account and talk about the resources that College Board, as well as ACT, because we now offer the ACT, the Practice ACT Aspire. So we'll spend some time talking about that whole process leading into the junior and senior year, where it gets much heavier into the post-high school planning. So those are our developmental guidance pieces of the curriculum, in addition to, you have the whole list there of all of the other things that are going on in 9th and 10th grade. And Penny Plasky's up.
Hi there, thanks for having us. It's my job to talk about what happens in 11th and 12th grade. By 11th grade, we really know the kids very well, as you can hear through the services that happen through 9th and 10th grade. And the goal is definitely in junior year, by the end of junior year, to have students know what their goal is for post-high school planning, whether that be college, which 90% of our kids do go on to 2 or 4 year, or other options, entering the workforce, going into the military, or vocational schools. So we start that, as Anne said, with the junior parent and junior college planning night, which is in early November. That is held in the auditorium. It's a large group presentation to go over what everybody needs to know in terms of planning, going through the timeline, the stressful topics of SATs and ACTs, and hopefully taking away some of the mystery of what you need to do when, and definitely juniors, the students are included in that presentation. From there, we have junior seminars, which are smaller group sessions, going over a lot of the same, but where each counselor is with their own counselees at that point, and that happens in January. We used to do all of this much later, but we were finding with the stress, it just definitely families were needing more information sooner. So at that point in January, once we go through, again, a little bit more of a small group session, students are required to make an individual appointment with their counselor. And those appointments will continue until the spring, so we can go through everything that they need to know. What is their testing plan specific to them based on their results of their PSAT? Should you try the ACT? Going over a resume, as Beth talked about, we've been encouraging them to do that in Naviance, but getting that more finalized in a better presentation in order to start that process, meeting with college admissions officers, eventually giving those to us as we continue through that process. Who should they ask to write their letters of recommendation? All of the logistics of the process, but at that point specific to that student. And most importantly, we're doing college searches with them. What are the things you're thinking of? Knowing full well these change. Our kids who say, I want to go to California. Not all of them stay with California, but you know, we honor their dream at that point. And as they visit and change and grow with what they're looking for with their families, we work with them. But certainly by the end of junior year, they've had 2 to 3 meetings with us to go through that, in addition to the individual course selection appointment, which is very important junior year, obviously, because we need to do the credit count extra carefully to make sure they have everything they need to graduate and to meet their post-high school plans. We do administer the PSAT, has already been said, the AP testing in May, as well as fall and spring administration of the SAT. We also added our college representatives do visit for our seniors in the fall. Juniors are always welcome, of course, but they're not always quite in that mode yet in fall of their junior year. So starting last year, through Anne and Carmen Mancuso in our Career Center, we have more college visits happening in the spring, which has been a nice resource for juniors, and that's growing. And related to our students who are not necessarily looking at two or four-year college in the traditional sense. This will be the 6th year we've held here, right here in this area, the library, the community college, and technical school fair. Just finding about 6 years ago, I started this program because it became obvious that these kids were feeling like they weren't really sure what their options are. Were they really getting the kind of services they need to figure out what they are? So we, and that has grown every year to more and more schools for them to consider. We also offer the ASVAB, which is the military vocational aptitude battery test that is offered, certainly for students who are looking to go into the military, but it's a great free battery, which as Beth said, tells you what you're good at, not necessarily what you're interested in, but definitely what are your strengths. But by the end of junior year, we want every student to know what their plan is and what their goal is. And we continue with that senior year. So we're in the thick of this right now. Seniors, I always say to them, you never can have too many appointments when you come in the fall. You know what we're crazy with up before senior year, right? So we are. We start off with senior seminars, so similar to those junior seminars, the logistics, the nuts and bolts, what do you have to do right now? These have already happened. Every senior has had this. With their own counselor, the overall process. If you haven't done this, you need to. This is how we get your transcripts out and those logistics. And then we head right into individual meetings. So many students have already had those individual meetings with their counselor to review and go over their college list, adjust if needed, certainly to assist them in filling out their applications. And I had one student in today who has filled out her entire common application, which was pretty impressive. We write every student a letter of recommendation, so every counselor is writing approximately 50 of those each year. And we prepare and send the transcript and recommendation package out, which 98% of the time is electronically through the Naviance program. We're always looking to grow. We all are involved with professional development. The college admissions scene is constantly changing. This is my 23rd year in it, and the rules change pretty much every year. So we've gone, some of the counselors were at a college board workshop today. We go on college tours, college breakfasts. I mean, we do our best while trying to do everything else that's already been discussed. It's hard to be out of school, but it's definitely time well spent when we can. And also looking to grow as the each senior fills out a senior survey to go through what services were helpful, what weren't. So we're forever changing and adjusting and looking at how we can do things better. But most importantly, we don't forget, all this talk has been about the students' emotional well-being and emotional health. This is a stressful process. So it sounds very, you know, I was thinking as I was preparing this, it's like very almost regimented that we do this, but keeping in mind that this is a stressful time for students and parents to go through. So I think we do a pretty good job of addressing that individually. And that's it. Thank you.
And Lori is going to speak about alternative school.
Hello, all. I promise to keep it brief. I will do my best. In short, I've recognized a handful of faces in here, and others are new to me. I started out my career here at Massac way back when as an intern with Lisa Bush, and then I got involved with alternate ed, and I realized how much I just enjoyed, in my mind, working with the underdog, because that's how I see alternate ed. And it was a passion of mine, and I had a door open in Trumbull, so I went to Trumbull alternate ed for some time, and I've come back about 2 years ago replacing Deb Simmons, and it's been a beautiful experience for me to be back at the family, the educational place where I started my career, working in a place for a woman who I deeply valued and acknowledged as a strong colleague of mine. But with that said, alternate ed is basically a safety net for kids who do not succeed in the general population at the high school. We are, in my mind, how we see ourselves as a safe haven. We are not a program where the misfits go. That is not us. This is a perception that I think a lot of alternate programs have that we're really trying to change. We are a program that addresses kids, the whole kid, academic issues. We have special ed population, regular ed population, 504 kids. We are a mix of a variety of different types of individuals within our school. Currently, we are only at 15, but it's the beginning of the year. And with alternative education, you get more kids as the year goes on because the challenges here become so intense for them, particularly those anxiety-ridden kids and those social phobia kids come out of the network. And you wonderful people up here are able to be sensitive to that and realize they may need a different, more unique environment like ours. So by the end of the year, we could be doubled. We could be at 30 or so. And we are also connected with Trumbull High School. So if Trumbull High School has some students that would benefit from some of our services, they will bring some of their high school population to us in our alternative program too. So our numbers right now are 15, but that will change. So again, we focus on the whole child, whole student. It's really our focus from my counseling perspective to instill can and will, because again, we're working with kids who are there because they're not reaching their full potential for different unique reasons. It could be family dynamics. It could be not so much that it's the student himself having the issue. It could be the parents. It could be the dynamic within that relationship. Work with families at large. I work with parents, speak with parents on a regular daily basis. That communication is ongoing. Our population of students can range from anxiety, depression, social phobias, family dynamics, I mentioned, emotional disturbances, poor self-esteem, poor peer adjustments, a lot of school avoidance issues, truancy issues, and substance use. We've worked with families that if they want us to work with those particular issues, even requiring urine test. We will work with that kid that intensely involved with that particular student with that family hand in hand. And then connecting with outside support services. I do a lot of work with outside programs that are attached to our kids. As our day ends at 12:45, these students, you know, here we are, have some teens that are all of a sudden free at 12:45. So then we need to look into, let's start looking into job, career services, and those that are not ready for that are more in treatment for from a therapeutic and counseling perspective, we connect a lot with particularly St. Vincent's program. They have a great outpatient program there for kids who have different emotional high-intensity needs there. We, as at the high school, we do groups on a daily basis. I do two groups a day. One group is more of a choices group, I call it, working about good choices and using coping skills, substance involvement, and making better choices for coping skills. The other group is more of a life skills, making good decision makings for yourself, teen issues, looking at friendships, discussing social media, cyberbullying, all those teen issues that you guys just have going on. It's a lot of what our youth is dealing with these days. Individual counseling on a regular basis. We're getting really involved with a lot of more community service involvement. We've been trying to, again, just kind of change what we're all about, doing some fundraising in the community. We had a great car wash in the spring. We did it on behalf of Doug Fedorkos. Unfortunately, his niece that he lost in a boating accident. We did a fundraiser for Doug and his function, and the kids were so thrilled to do that. We raised $500, and they loved just being able to give Doug that check, and they felt good about what it is that they were doing. So just instilling in these kids to give back and what it feels like to give back. And I feel very blessed to be part of just a small family, so to speak, in reaching the kids like this. And it's really been a blessing. And I think sometimes certain families, when their child is referred to us, we can be looked at as, the saying goes, looking a gift horse in the mouth, so to speak, because we get, oh, I don't want my child in alternative ed. But when you break it down and see what it is and what a small setting we are and the therapeutic component that it's attached and all the transitioning planning that we have, because we never like to, a student to graduate from us, whether it be coming back to Massac or graduate as whole without what's next is planned. So we work tightly connected with guidance up here, and Jen Purcells has been down. We're working with our seniors now. We have six seniors this year. I've made a great connection with a prior Massac graduate, actually, who opened his own company doing transition services for kids. Joel Singer. I don't know, but he's going for his doctorate, so I'll have to put that'll give him a little bit of but he being it just speaks so much about this community, because here's a man that I was able to meet through just reaching out to different communities and seeing what we could get for free for our kids. And once realizing he was a Massac graduate, he said, let me come up and meet you guys. He did an in-service for free. He got to see what it is that we do, and now he's offering his services to us every Friday for the next 6 weeks, just out of the generosity of his own heart, because he wants to give back to his community. So that just has something to say about this place that we all work in. And I got off topic, but I just had to share that, because that's just good stuff, and that's just what I like to be part of.
It is.
So that's us, and if you have questions, that's where you'll find me.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
And everybody's welcome to come into a classroom or come see us and visit us. We're not here at the Board of Education meetings very often, so this is our time to really share with you all these great programs. Once again, our goal is to be proactive, not reactive. We want to have every youth in Monroe reach their potential. That's our goal, you know, in all different types of ways. And the challenge, and we're putting forth this to you, is, you know, across, I've been here, you know, looking at our program, the ratio of one counselor to 900 plus students in the elementary school, the incredible job done at Monroe L and also done at Stepney and Fawn Hollow, we cannot service all of those kids like we can at Monroe L based on the ratio. Mio does a fantastic job in the classroom, but when you have 927 students, it's just, you're not able to get to everybody. And it's the one area where I feel just assessing the department is really lacking. And when my first time when I went in and Tracy Sacco was a new counselor, it was like the first week of school, I'm in first grade, she comes in, Tracy introduces me, and Tracy asks, well, what did you learn? Remember Mrs. Young from last year? She's up at the high school, this lady works with her. What did you hear from Mrs. Young about being a good person? And every first grader, I get the shivers just talking about this, because if I could cry easily, I would. They raised their hand, every single student, and every single student in first grade in the second week of school was like, oh, Miss Young taught me in a guidance lesson how to bring kids in from recess if they're feeling excluded, like how to go talk to somebody. Oh, she told me to help somebody. And the kids went on and on. I was like, this is powerful. And that's what I think we want to share with you. There's fantastic people here doing great things with kids. And, you know, we feel like that piece of it is an area of challenge. And we're really hopeful that we'll be able to overcome that challenge so we can give that quality of education and social emotional development to every student, no matter what elementary school they're in. They're getting this quality comprehensive school guidance curriculum. Thank you so much for all of your time. We know it was long, it's late at night. We really appreciate your time. I don't know if anybody has any questions of us or anything like that.
Alan?
Yes, Alan.
I just want to say thank you for all the great work you're doing. I was just wondering, in addition to the groups and the individual counseling, getting kids ready for college, how do you split up the 504s?
It's all alphabetical.
Okay.
Okay, so in the high school, it's alphabetical. You know, Tracy and Mia are sole people, so they have all the 504s. And in the middle school, I believe it's a grade level,
right,
by grade level.
Because I know it's a lot of paperwork.
Yes, yeah, yes.
In addition to that, you go to PPT meetings as well?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Yes, I didn't put that on there, though. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else have any questions? Thank you so
much. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you,
we really appreciate it. Thank you, Jenny. Thank you so much.
Okay, so we'll put off the survey one for next meeting. We can talk a little bit about that later. But what we wanted to talk about, what I wanted to share with you, is what to expect from this SBAC testing. We've seen a lot of it on TV and read it in the newspaper. What are we going to expect from our testing to Monroe? Not going to give you the specific scores, because in a couple of weeks, Joe and I are going to sit here and go over all the data, and that'll be a long one. But we're going to go through all the data and talk about that. But right now, I just want to talk a little bit about what to expect from the testing. I think it's very important that when we look at all this new initiatives that have happened, we see them in four separate pods. The standards, we used to have standards, they were called Connecticut Framework, and we always used those, and now we have Connecticut Core Standards. So Connecticut took the Common Core Standards and called them Connecticut Core Standards. So those are the standards. We have Monroe Curriculum, and that curriculum is reviewed and evaluated and revised every year, or every like in a cycle, but we look at the curriculum every year, and some of you are members of the curriculum committee. That's Monroe's curriculum to match the standards, to look at the standards. Then there's two teaching strategies, and Monroe has a lot of initiatives. You've heard a lot of them over the years, BYOT, initiative about
inquiry.
All the initiatives that we have put down, group learning, cooperative group learning, performance-based assessments, all that stuff. Those are the teaching strategies that the teachers do in the classroom. And then there's the standardized testing. And we had standardized testing, CAPTAIN, CMT, if you remember that. And now we have SBAC, and what we heard from the governors, we have SBAC and SAT. So these are four distinct piles. And what we hear all the time is, I don't like that Common Core. And when I ask, what does that mean, they'll say things, well, about testing. Well, that's different. The Common Core is the standards, the curriculum is what we do in Monroe, the teaching strategies is what the teachers do, and the standardized testing is how we measure, see how well we've done with that. So I just wanted to make sure we got through the four different boxes, so to speak. There is a shift in expectations. When we took the CAPTAIN CMT, it was a proficiency test, and it tested the Connecticut Framework standards. Now this SBAC is called the preparedness test, and it's preparing kids for college and work beyond high school, and these are the new Connecticut core standards. So there's a shift in the expectations. Why the shift? Well, there's been different standards across different states. We talked about that. You know, what's a third grade standard in Vermont is different than what's third grade standard in Connecticut and Alabama. They're different. And now these common standards are together. It's global. It's just not competing with districts in Connecticut, but we're going to be looking at how well we did in the nation. And we're going to prepare the students with what the skills they need to be successful in college and careers, and that's important. And this is, the expectations are the same no matter where you live, and that's been different over the years. You've heard some things about other states not in our area, who they said that 80-90% of the kids were proficient in reading, but then when they took the NAEP test, which was a world, you know, an international test, or this SBAC, it showed a much different result. So what we're saying is now these standards are going to be, the expectations are going to be consistent, and we're going to see what's going on. And it's a clear, focused guide post what kids are going to, what we want kids to know be able to do in third grade, what we want kids to know be able to do in fourth grade. So, you know, I'm going to show you this because I think this is a really good video that just explains the SBAC testing.
My name is Sarah Brown Wessling. I'm a high school English teacher at Johnston High School in Johnston, Iowa. Getting up in the morning and going to school never feels like a job to me. My students fuel me in the most amazing ways. I hope that they will be lifelong learners. I hope that they will be able to find their passions and go pursue them. The first thing I would say to parents as these new assessments are being rolled out is to take a deep breath. The idea is that they will replace the assessments that have already been in place. We have new assessments because we have different standards, and the standards are promoting skills like critical thinking, problem solving, being able to reason and explain that reasoning. We need an assessment that really matches those standards. The easiest way to really see the differences in the assessments is to take a look at them online. We are going to take a look at the fifth grade math assessment from PARC. Students will have lots of tools available, like a ruler, a calculator, or a notepad, which allows them to keep track of their thinking and their reasoning so they can explain it in the answer. Here, in order to demonstrate an understanding of fractions, the student must create his own comparison and explain why certain reasoning is incorrect. Here, students need to use a drag and drop feature and answer multiple parts to a question. So students have to understand more than just a single concept. When asked to find the volume of a cube, students are asked first to show the equation and formula they used, and then to type how they found their answer. So that's math. But what about English? Well, it's actually pretty similar. Let's take a look. Here, instead of just selecting a word to describe characters from the passage, students have to describe two characters and use a line from the text that supports their choice. In this question, students will have to read two passages about penguins and compare them. You'll notice the details contain concepts like point of view and present tense. In order to answer it correctly, they need to know some academic vocabulary. Using the same articles about penguins, students will now be asked to watch an additional video and write an essay. As you can probably guess, they'll be required to use information from the sources in their essay. This is where the highlighting tool comes in handy. What I really like about these assessments is, first of all, the way that they match the standards that we're already teaching. The second thing is the way they're asking questions differently. They're asking students to demonstrate their mathematical reasoning skills. They're prompting students to make compelling arguments. They are asking students to work with a diverse set of texts and synthesize those. These are all the skills we know students need in the real world. The results of these assessments can be used by parents and teachers alike to really figure out where students are at in their continuum of learning. So for some students, that means we might be able to decide they need a little bit more help. For other students, we may learn that they need to be pushed a little bit and they need to be challenged by going deeper into a subject matter. We need to be able to understand how students are continually working and struggling with these challenging skills. So we want students to take these assessments not so that we can tell them that they're good or bad or they got it right or wrong. We want them to take these assessments so that it can inform instruction. If you have more questions, check out the website bealearninghero.org, where you can get tips to help support your child, information on the assessment, practice assessments, and a lot of other great resources as well.
I couldn't have said better and really presented it well. She did a really nice job, I thought, about that. What's the difference between preparedness and proficiency, and what are we going to see differently? And, you know, with these new tests, we're going to receive new scores. I'm going to show you a little bit.
Hello, my name is Jennifer Phillips.
Hello, Jennifer.
I'm a teacher here in Colorado.
I guess I needed to get rid of this. Okay. So results may look a little different. And, you know, performance may look lower on the Smarter Balance test than they have for us on Captain CMT. Although in Monroe,
not so much.
We did pretty well. But these standards are rigorous. And I think we did well because we embraced these Common Core standards and our kids really rose to the level. And you're going to see that in a few weeks. We're really happy about where we are with many of our scores. So we're going to show you that. But it's expected that these scores are going to be different. And they may be different for your child for the Smarter Balance than it was for Captain CMT. And it may be different. And the reason is that they're not learning less, but that these standards are higher, rigorous standards. And we want to see how well our kids have done. And again, we're going to talk about that when we meet, and I think you're going to be pleased with what you see. I put this up there because this looks exactly like the Captain CMT report that came out to you years ago. So that's what it looks like as a whole, and then you'll see it exactly like you saw the Captain CMT. ELA and math, what level they are. Now, there's not five levels, there's only four levels, and that's explained in the results. But you'll see just exactly like they did on the CMT and CAT. They also have these claims. You'll see down at the bottom, this is for ELA, literacy, and you'll see there's claims, reading, writing, listening, research, and inquiry. And you'll see even those specific areas, if your student is above standards or at or near standard, and then you'll see how they compare to the school's average and the district's average. So you'll see where they are. Are they close to that level three? Look at the student's score. It's almost a level four. It's close. So you'll be able to see that, just like you could in the CMT and CAT. And again, the same thing for math. The claims are there, concepts and procedures, problem solving and modeling, and communicating reasoning, and it's there. And you'll see if they're at or near those claims, as well as the overall score. One of the things I thought was very interesting, along with these score sheets, you're going to get a booklet. Now, this booklet is based on the grade that your child's in, so this is for a fourth grade student. What you'll see as a parent is you'll see what they should have or what they did learn in third grade in both math and language arts, and what they're going to learn in fourth grade and see how it compares. You will also see how you as a parent or how a parent can help their child. And the first part is the free thing. Encourage your child to use what they already know, play math games with your kids in the car. You'll see those kinds of things. But then you'll also see there are other resources that you can use, like Khan Academy and other kinds of games. So this is going to be sent along with the test scores, so parents will be able to see how they can help their child. The other thing I found is this website that allows parents, and we're going to put this on our website so parents can see, it allows parents to pick a grade and see exactly what their scores mean. So fifth grade ELA literacy skills, what that is, fifth graders thinking, writing, and speaking is becoming more organized. You'll notice, for example, that they use introduction quotations and conclusions to present their information clearly. You can find out exactly what that means, and then you can find out how you can help your child. So there's a lot more resources for parents with this new test. And really the stuff that we looked at, it's really good stuff. You know, some final thoughts. You know, it's important that we understand that this is a test, that the expectations are more rigorous, that they're higher than they've ever been before, and there's indicators of preparedness. We want to make sure that they know it's not just proficiency, but it's preparing them for high school and beyond. How will we know where the students are? This test isn't going to tell us that. This is all, it's all over. You know, they've already had the year, they're taking the test, it's all done. Nothing we can really do about it except look at how well the group did as a whole. But we are going to give benchmark assessments that were developed by our teachers, but the state is also coming up with interim assessments so that teachers can give it periodically throughout the year to see what skills they need to work on that their kids aren't getting in the classroom. It's going to inform instruction, but teacher-made assessment. I think we've said this before, but I really think it's worth saying again, these tests are only one measure. What's really important is you got to look at that one measure, but also look at what's happening in the classroom. Get the teacher feedback, the parent conferences. That's what's important. That's where you know where your child stands. So it's really important to only realize that this is one measure. Now, 2 weeks from now, I'm going to tell you, because we did so well, it's the only
measure. It's
the
best measure, right?
But right now, we're going to say it's really only one measure. Look at the one measure, but really look at what's happening in the classroom. And then what we're going to do from here is we're going to keep looking at what the state provides us, what information we get from our interim assessments and the final assessments, and we're going to make changes in the classroom instruction so we can help meet the standards. We are not teaching to the test. We are not teaching to the test. We're not going to do that. We have never done that with Captain CMT. We're not about to do that with SBAC. But we are going to look at how well we did on the standards so that we can help make sure our kids know where they need to be successful. So, more to come.
Okay. Anybody have any questions for John on this? Thank you.
This has been a tremendous effort by people like John and Sheila and our principals and instructional leaders to make this all work over the past couple of years. And I think you can be very, very proud of the work that our teachers and the leadership has done to make sure that our kids are successful on this.
All right. There is no old business. So we will be moving on to new business, and we are looking for a motion to approve adding $46,717.74 of unexpended funds from the 2014-15 school operating budget to the capital reserve account per state statute 10-248A.
So moved.
Thank you. Do I have a second? Thank you. Any discussion on this? This is our unexpended funds from last year's budget that we want to move forward with that capital reserve. All right, hearing none, all in favor? All right, we will move on to adjournment. Do I have a motion to adjourn? Thank you. Thank you. Second? Thank you. All in favor? Thank you, everybody, very much. Productive, informative meeting tonight.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.